Okay, I have 5:30. So I would like to convene this meeting of the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District on April 1st, 2021. Would you call the roll, Holly?
President Mayhood?
Here.
Vice President Henry?
Here.
Director Falls?
Here.
And Director Smalley?
Here.
Okay. Are there any additions or deletions to the closed session agenda?
I have none.
Then we move to that part of the agenda that is for oral communications from the public regarding items that are in the closed session. Do we have any members of the public here? I do not.
No, we do not.
I don't see any. Okay. All right. If that's the case, then we will now adjourn to closed session, and I'll see you in a minute or two. Okay, I have 6:30. So let's convene to the open session. There are no actions to be reported from the closed session. So reconvening this meeting of the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District of April 1st, 2021. Holly, would you call the roll, please?
Director Mayhood?
Here.
Vice President Henry?
Here.
Director Falls?
Here.
Director Smalley?
Here.
Thank you.
Okay. Are there any additions or deletions to the agenda for tonight?
Staff have none.
All right. Then we go on to oral communications from the public. This is your chance to talk about anything that is within the purview of the district, but is not on the agenda tonight. And let's see, I see Jim Mosher. Can we go ahead and allow Jim Mosher to speak?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Hi, my name's Jim Mosher from Felton, and I just want to commend the Water District. I walked in the Felton Library Park today, and the work under the solar panels with the chip, it looked so great. So I really appreciate the district. I know AmeriCorps worked on that, but a great improvement for the community, and appreciate the district's collaborating with the library and the park department to turn that space into something special. Thanks.
Great. Thanks for that. Anyone else? Seeing none, hearing none, we will go ahead and go on to new business, which is about board member resignation and filling that vacancy. Rick, did you want to start?
It's the board member resignation, board of directors vacancy. District Council Nichols will present that item to the board.
Okay, thank you, District Manager Rogers, Chair Mayhood. On just before the last regular board meeting on March 18th, the district received an email written resignation from Director Tu, stating that she was resigning for personal reasons, and that resignation is provided in the board packet for reference. The process going forward, so that as a result of that resignation, the board now has a vacancy on the board of directors, and the government code provides a process to fill the vacant board seat. The options available to the board include filling the vacancy by an appointment made by the board. Alternatively, the board could decide to fill the vacancy by an election, or the board could take no action. However, the deadline to either make an appointment or call for an election is May 17th. And if the district were to exercise neither of those options by that time, the matter would go to the County Board of Supervisors to fill the vacancy. The staff is recommending that the district follow an appointment process which is that the district has to post the notice of vacancy within the district for at least 15 days prior to the appointment. The district, when this has occurred in the past, has typically provided more than 15 days to give interested individuals an opportunity to, you know, to decide that they want to apply and to put together materials here. The proposed timeline, if the board decides to follow the staff's recommendation and make an appointment, the proposed timeline is set forth in the board packet, and it would be that the notice of vacancy would get posted tomorrow. And then the last date for the receipt of applications would be Wednesday, April 28th. So it would be almost a month to respond. And that would give staff enough time to compile the applications into the board packet for the May 1st, for the first regular meeting in May, which is May 6th. And then the last date to make an appointment, as I said, is May 17th. So if the district failed to make an appointment on May 6th, there may be a need to call for a special meeting to further consider the applications. And with that, I would ask the board to direct staff how they wish to proceed. And there is a proposed motion should the board decide to follow the staff's recommendation.
Okay, Director Henry, would you like to start off our discussion?
I would. I believe that we need to appoint. If we go to election, there'd only be a four-member board, and we could have a problem doing anything if votes became 2-2. And besides, going to election costs a lot of money. And it costs the people who are interested in being on the board, but maybe don't have the money that it would cost if you go to election. So I support appointing someone as soon as possible.
Thank you. Director Smalley?
Yes. I wasn't part of this process prior to my being appointed to the board. So I'd like to ask a couple of general questions first and then make a comment or so. Gina, if we go the route of appointment, is it okay for us as board members to reach out to individuals within the community to, one, let them know about this, and to sound out a potential interest in individuals?
Well, that's a tough one for me to respond to. I'm not aware of any rules that prevent that. But I guess I'll leave it at that.
Okay. After the applications are in front of us as board members, but prior to the interview process, which I went through, is it okay for me as a board member to contact any of these applicants just to sound them out ahead of time? Or?
Well, legally, that's where it starts to get a little trickier. Once you have a pool of applicants, right. let me say this. The issue from a legal perspective is Brown Act. And so,
right.
For example, you know, when new board members are elected to the board before they're seated, you have to assume that the Brown Act applies because, you know who the directors are going to be. So you could, by analogy, you could apply that logic, you know, by analogy to the appointment process and say that if there's a chance that you can tell who's likely to be appointed as a result of the process, then you potentially have a Brown Act problem with, you know, multiple directors contacting them and talking to them. So that's right. A legal issue from my perspective.
I see. Okay. Comment that I have is I'm aware that the board has received three emails from members of the public, and all three of them supporting the process of appointing somebody to the board. Having been appointed, I am in favor of the process also. Given that, I'd like to make the motion to proceed with filling the vacancy of Director Tu's seat on the board by an appointment. Applicants interviewed during the first board meeting in May, which is scheduled for May 6th. The appointments would serve until the seat is filled in connection with the November 2022 general election.
Second.
Okay. Then let's hear from Director Fultz before we go out to the public, but let's confine our remarks to the motion that's on the table, please.
I'll reserve my question and comment until after we hear from the public.
Okay. Do we have any questions or comments? We do. Okay. Rick Moran.
Good evening. Rick Moran from Ben Lomond. I've been on both sides of this process. I was appointed and I participated in the when Steve Swan resigned. So there's a and one of the things that concerns me is that this seat is being held only for 2 years, although her position would have been held to 2024. You're cutting it in half, and in 2022, there's going to be four open seats. That's not the way the board was set up, and I think there's a problem in doing that. You know, maybe obvious to other people, but, you know, there's going to be four new people, possibly new people. It helps with some stability if we have some people that stay on. And I think that's the reason why the 2-3 split was initially set up that way. So I see there's a problem if we're going to have four people elected in 2022. Thank you.
Thank you, Rick. I'll just comment that I totally understand your concern, especially since I'll be the one person there that is holding down the fort. But we're doing exactly what the California state law requires, that if somebody resigns in the first half of their term, then basically it can only be filled until the next general election. So this was not something that was our option. It was what the state law says. Larry Ford.
Thank you. This is Larry Ford from Felton. I too am in favor of an appointment. I think it's really important to get a fifth board member on the board without delay. I think that good candidates can be found and that you'll have a good an opportunity to select among other good candidates. So I don't see any reason to cause a delay or expense, as Director Henry said. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Nancy Macy.
Thank you. Nancy Macy from Boulder Creek. Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to give our voices in on this. I do concur that it's far too expensive and too time consuming to do a campaign. And I do hope that you will be willing to deal with the 4-1 as it comes up in 2 years. I'm certainly hoping that there will be people on the board now who will want to run again and get reelected. Have so much respect for everyone there. I just wanted to add my voice. I agree that it should be an appointment. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. Karen Hall.
Yeah, it feels like we had, or the board had this discussion just 2 months ago, and came to a decision that the appointment made the most sense that everybody said. And there were, as we know, quite a number of excellent candidates who applied. And we chose one, but there were, I think, were a couple of others that had also had important helpful qualifications. And so it seems like kind of a no-brainer now to go ahead and follow that same process again, rather than spending a lot of time rediscussing the same issue.
Thank you. Thank you, Karen. Jim Mosher?
Yes, Jim Mosher from Felton. First, I agree with the other speakers that we should go with the appointment process, but I just want to say that I also agree with Rick Moran that I think it is an issue that we're going to have four people up for election. And I wondered if the board could explain to ratepayers how that election would work, since three of those terms would be four-year terms and one would be a two-year term. Would people have to apply specifically for the two-year term? Would that be a separate election from the four-year term? Or would it just be one election with everybody running for the seats and the one who got the fourth most votes would get the two-year term? I'm just curious how that would work, because I couldn't figure it out from looking at the code.
Gina, you wanna try to answer that one?
I wish I could. I haven't worked out the answer to that question, but I will do that.
Alina Lang?
Hi, yeah. Alina Lang from Boulder Creek. And I just wanted to say that I support the appointment process as well. I think you've kind of gone over it, but the cost just seems like a lot on our ratepayers. And so I definitely support the appointment process. Thank you.
Thank you, Alina. Anybody else? Hearing none, seeing none, we'll go back to the board. And Director Fultz, did you want to go ahead and make a comment now?
Yeah, a couple of things regarding Jim's question about the seats. Based on what I've seen before, yes, it is a sort of separate application for the two-year seat, but Gina can confirm that. Gina, a couple of questions for you. When would the next election be?
Director Fultz, do you mean the next election if the district were to call for an election to fill this vacant board seat?
Yes, correct.
That would be November of this year.
And on your concern about the Brown Act violations, I'm not sure I understand the concern. So, a director independently contacting the candidates, how does that violate the Brown Act again?
Well, consider the situation if you have, five board members, two of them outgoing, three incoming, and, right before they take the board, one of them meets with the two remaining directors to kind of work out what they're going to do on, with district business once they take office. That would be a Brown Act problem. Here, just for an extreme example, imagine if there's only one applicant, only one person applies, and it seems likely that they're going to be appointed. Then there's potentially a Brown Act issue if, for example, two existing directors sit down and meet with that person to plot out what they're going to do, assuming that person is appointed.
All right. So let me make sure I understand that. So the issue is if there's just a single applicant, in which case at that point it's effectively the same situation after an election, in that the people know who's going to be on the board, and so you're all subject to the Brown Act at that point.
Right. It turns on the degree to which you know who the board members are going to be and you're coordinating with them about district business.
Right. But if there's, like last time, if there's five applicants, how does talking to each of those applicants violate the Brown Act?
Well, I'm not sure that it does. It's in a gray area, right?
I'm not sure I understand where even the gray area would be.
Well, like, you know, a lot of things under the Brown Act kind of turn on facts and circumstances. So if somebody could show that, you know, it's understood that one of those people is definitely going to get appointed for some reason, and I can't predict why that would be the case.
But that would require sort of violations of the Brown Act on the existing sitting board members, if that was clear, because at that point, you know, presumably they're giving the person their assurance they're going to vote for them. I mean, effectively, that almost becomes a sort of a serial type of meeting, particularly if that person were to inform the other board members about that. I don't see where it's gray. I'm and maybe this is something we can talk about offline then, because it seems relatively black and white to me. It's sort of like having you know, five candidates for two seats in an election process, and you're talking to people. I don't know that you get into Brown Act violation during a regular campaign, but yeah, maybe we can talk about that offline. So I did want to address the issue of elections versus appointments. So my preference is still for elections as a means to fill vacancies. The issue we have here is the extreme lack of flexibility in current California government code to facilitate that. There's only a certain number of election dates that are currently set up, and that's a different number for odd versus even years. And we have no ability to do vote by mail as a special election for replacing directors. So these are things that need to be addressed by the state legislature, particularly in light of the sort of modern world that we live in, where these things appear to be a lot more common than they used to be. And that is, unfortunately, nothing that we can take care of tonight, but hopefully that will be something we can continue to work with our state legislators on, to bring more flexibility into this process than currently exists. I am not persuaded by this focus on quote unquote cost control. Since we seem to be focused on cost control only in the one area where the people have their voices known in a direct fashion on the selection of who's going to represent them. We don't do a lot of cost control anywhere else. So if cost control really is an issue for folks, then I hope everybody will join together as we start addressing things like the budget and other spending that we do that, in my opinion, goes well above and beyond what we should be doing. To me, the top priority for spending on any kind of government agency is in fact the ability of the people to directly select who their representatives are going to be. I'm also concerned about the fact that should we have one more vacancy, then if we continue this approach, we would have a majority of people appointed to the board. I believe our local school district ran into this issue and found that a bridge too far. This isn't something that we should just dismiss out of hand. But unfortunately, again, given the current government code, we simply don't have a lot of flexibility at this point.
Okay, we have a motion that has been made and seconded. Holly, could you take the roll call vote, please?
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Aye.
Director Foles?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
Okay. Motion passes.
Thank you. So we will proceed on the process of announcing this tomorrow, and hopefully we'll have it back to us by May 6th. Okay. The next item on the agenda is a discussion of the preliminary budget rollup.
Yes, the Director of Finance and Business Manager will start this presentation to the board.
Hello, so this is a high level rollup of kind of the budget process for where we are right now, which is the majority being operating expenses and operating revenues, and then some of the other non-operating expenses and revenues. This was visited in great detail at the Budget and Finance Committee. So we provided the link in there to where people want to go see kind of the line by line detail that's going into each department. You're able to kind of go back and see that. But overall, revenue is tracking as expected given the slated rate increases. We are factoring in slight reductions in consumption. This current fiscal year, 2021, we're projecting to finish at around 675,000 units of water, and then we're tailoring 2% off of each year going down from that. There is only the one slated increase in this coming November that's in the budget. Since there is no other rate studies, we did not put any others in the future year. This budget does include the proposed fire recovery surcharge of $5 million over the five-year period. So that is $1 million in each year. High level from the expenses is there is one new hire in the budget for an assistant to the district manager. There's two promotions for the water treatment supervisor and environmental planner. There's $100,000 in there for a new rate study. There's $40,000 for going digital. And then in the capital budget, which factors in a little bit to the operating expenses, is we're budgeting for 1,000 new Badger meters to go into the ground. There is the monthly fee associated with those transmitting out. And so that has $11,000 in each year going up as well. We are in the thick of the capital process right now. The other side of it is we are also busy reconciling the FEMA projects and projecting how much capital contributions we're going to be getting reimbursed from FEMA. So the capital piece is going to kind of be the bit coming next. This is a fluid situation. District staff have been great at adapting to the biennial budget process. And so we'll still have different things coming in that will have changes. Ones that we know of right now is we got a quote for the next fiscal year from our insurance provider. It came in $30,000 more than what we were originally budgeting. So right off the bat, I'll be adding $30,000 to the next fiscal year, which will increase the following one as well. Additionally, the past conversation that we just had, an election will be happening irregardless in fiscal year 2022. So there's actually about another $30,000 that needs to get added to that 22-23 year budget. We then provided some of the high-level summaries, and similar to last year, some of the next steps that we'll be doing at the Budget and Finance Committee is bridging kind of the exact amounts for each of the different categories for what caused the increases or decreases in the different areas. It also does, since we went biennial, it is flowing a little bit more left to right to where you're seeing the proposed budgets in the further columns to the right, where prior budgets, it was showing up in the left. So I just want to make sure everyone kind of pays attention to the titles of the different columns. But it's showing overall operating revenues being around kind of what we adopted in this year's budget, the 11.3. It's going to be kicking up to the 12.9 in fiscal year 21-22, and then going up to just a little bit more, 13 million. You're not seeing the increase because there isn't any slated rate increases in there. Operating expenses, you can see the fluctuations going from a projected 8.5 up to 8.8 and then up to 9.2 in the future years. Interest expense and debt payments is factoring in all of our new debt. It is not factoring in anything new. I'm not quite sure if we'll be getting another loan by fiscal year 22-23. It may be the year after that. but it shows what the total income is for each of the different years. We're projecting this year to be around 2.4. And then next year, the first year in the biennial at 3.3, and then 3.1 for that final year. And then the subsequent slides are just going into a little bit more detail in each of those categories. So this is probably a good point for us to stop and see if any of the board members have specific questions to the budget.
Director Smalley, would you like to start?
Certainly, I have several. On the expenses that you were showing us on page 22, Stephanie, are those just to make us aware of this point, or are we being asked to approve those at this point in this discussion?
No one's being asked to approve anything yet. You know, it's very important. You know, we like to get you all involved early on so that if there's any major issues that people see or want to discuss, we have time to update them. Once we get the capital piece and see how it all rolls up, that's really when we're going to be able to have a meaningful conversation to see what it's doing to reserves. Are we pulling from reserves? Are we adding to reserves? That's where we can kind of have the more detailed questions. So no approval is being desired tonight.
On page 23, I see that water usage revenue is up by 550K, but usage is down by 2%. So we should sell less water to make more money?
There's a rate increase.
Well, that's the rate increase. I understand. Okay. On page 23, I see contract and professional services up by 150K over prior year. What's that related to?
So a lot of that is going to be coming from the amounts that we kind of called out up above. We have 100 grand in there for a new rate study. There also is additional 40 grand in there for going digital campaign. The offsetting negative.
Okay. So
legal's tracking higher this year, mm-hmm. and we're projecting it'll go down next year.
Okay. And then likewise, operating expenses being up by 90K over last year. Have we brought on new systems, or do we have new things that we're operating?
So James can probably speak a little bit to that. We do have some increased run rates from the CZU fires that are being factored in to some of these as well.
Yeah, and there is a, we run a 7% increase on telecommunications and power utilities every year due to the rate increases of those. And so those are 7%, which are spelled out in the budget that we submitted. And then there's other things like contract services that have increased due to natural disasters. So we're trying to forecast for PG&E power shutoffs, natural disasters. We're trying to have some money in there to back up those kind of things.
And there's also an increase in power costs and chemical costs due to the CZU fire and switching from surface water to well water. Because we do not have those surface waters until the pipelines are repaired. So there'll be an increased cost in that as well.
Okay. Okay. And then on page 25, I see admin expenses increasing by 371K.
And so that admin is where the rate study will hit. That's where the going digital campaign will be hitting. We did put in more. We put in money for the PR firm, but that's where those are kind of coming from. And so, if you ever want to go back and look, they're very detailed.
Okay.
But if that budget link, it shows each department, and depending on the department, I mean, 100 is broken down pretty much line by line for what's making up.
Right. Okay. So. if those are admin expenses, and one specific one that you mentioned there was the rate study that we were going to have to do. I thought I heard that as part of the 115K in contract professional services. Is that?
So each department has a contract professional service, has each of those different categories. So mm-hmm. the page that you're looking at is just a different way to look at it. The one that we were talking about before goes by category. And then the one that you're looking at shows another perspective by each department overall.
Okay. Okay. So it's not putting the same fees in two different buckets to...
No, no.
Okay. Okay. All right. That's all of my questions. Thank you.
Director Falls?
Yes, I have a number of questions. Let me start at the top here. What is the approved headcount for budget year 2020-2021?
The one that we're in now, 35.
What is the projected ending actual headcount for 2021?
35.
And what is the requested headcount going to be for 21-22?
36. It's just that one position.
And what is, I'm not sure I understand the function of this position. What will this person be doing?
Okay. This will, I know this will get a lot of attention tonight, but I needed to bring this to the board's attention. This would be a high level management position. It would be very similar to what Soquel Creek has as a special projects manager. The position would work closely with myself and department heads on completing objectives and getting a lot of the goals and objectives over the finish line. A lot of it would be this individual would work closely with the department heads and managers on the paperless operations of the full district, file storage, reorganization of our administrative functions and customer service for the post-pandemic, moving in that direction of electronics and digital. We would also, this position would work on outreach, continue with the website that we've stalled on and haven't been able to get the website to where I would consider completed with the engineering section, additional customer service for the post-pandemic historical documentation and the historical library. The CIP program needs to be updated and brought to the website. The district engineer's plate is very full with all of the CZU fires and all of the capital improvement projects. He needs help on getting this up and running on the internet. And then once this is developed, he will be able to continue to update it. Scheduling of the many capital improvement projects, it would be a high-level position that would work with the existing department heads to bring so many of these programs that are just get stalled. We get them 75-80% of the way, and then we don't get them completed because we just don't have the time. We would also be involved in putting together manuals and procedure manuals for different things, an onboarding manual. There's so many things that we need to get completed that aren't getting completed and won't get completed, not unless we get some additional high-level help. I do believe over time, over the first year, there will be reductions in other expenses in outreach. There will be, could be potential reductions in legal costs due to the fact that we use legal counsel to prepare a lot of documents that really a high-level staff person could prepare, and she could just do the high-level review. We could do a lot more in-house, I believe, with the outreach and reduce the cost of a consultant on outreach. I don't have what those numbers would look like right now, but that would be the direction I'd be going in.
Yeah, Rick, thanks for going through all that. I guess from the description and the agenda, that I didn't walk away with that. What you described sounds more like a assistant district manager. As opposed to a district secretary or an executive assistant.
Well, Bob, I've been putting this together, bouncing around, looking at other agencies, and I've talked with a couple of the directors to get an impression of their thinking. I've been massaging this position, and I've not quite fine-tuned it yet. You know, we're still in the draft stages. It's kind of a placeholder. I'm getting very close, but I haven't fine-tuned it. I do not want it supervisorial. I don't believe it needs to be a supervisorial position. It just needs to be a high-level person to work with department heads to give them the extra support and the long-range support.
Yeah, I get that. And the number of the projects that you listed would probably reach conclusion within a year. Are you envisioning this being just a one-year thing or a multi-year?
2 years, and then reassess. 2 years, then reassess to see if I've met my goals of reduction in consultants and a notable increase in work product.
Okay, interesting. As you know, when you start adding additional headcount, that typically is a very, very long-term commitment to that person, to their expense, to their retirement, to the whole package. And so it becomes adding headcount is in this sector something that needs to be approached with caution because of it.
Agreed.
I certainly like the notion of going digital or going green or whichever. I'll get to it here in a bit. But one other question about the Badger meters. We had a number of Badger meters in the budget for this year. Are those going to be able to be done given the other things that we had to do as a result of the fire return?
I'll let James and Stephanie give you an update on this year's progress.
Yeah, so right now we are pretty close to getting, we had 500 meters in the budget, I do believe, Stephanie, is that right?
Yep.
I believe it was 1,000 as well.
No, it was cut to 500.
Oh, that's right. Yes.
So one of the things that we've run into is we have had excessive amounts of dead meters out there. So my team has really been chasing a lot of dead meters out there this year. We have been working on the Felton COP program as well. We have not gotten as far along with that as we wish to, as we've been actually having to borrow meters from that program to do the dead meter change out because there's been so many of them over this last year.
Well, this is something that we might want to dive into a little bit deeper at a future meeting. As I've expressed before, I have serious concerns about spiking meter replacements in a small number of years as opposed to doing them more over a period of a period of time so that it's flat. Basically, you just replace X number of meters every year, and over 15 years, you replace the whole thing.
Right,
So to hear about the dead meters and all that, I had not heard that, and that's definitely something we should dive into later.
Bob, can I just speak to that real quick? That's where we're really getting a lot of stuff, is that's where we're trying to catch up on the meters, is a lot of the meters are starting to go dead. And so that's why we've been trying to do a higher level of a change out in order to catch up on and get ahead of those dead meters.
Well, the reason probably that a lot of them are going dead is about 12 years ago, we did a similar spike in the meter replacement where we replaced something like, I think it was 6,000 meters in 3 years. So of course, what happens if everything goes out at that time, and if you're not setting aside money to be able to do that, it then tends to distort your capital spending when those spikes occur again, which is why you don't want to get into spikes in the service business. So anyway, that we can cover that later in more detail. Still to come, Stephanie, on the capital obligations that we have. So is that something that will then be coming back to the board with a more detailed breakdown of all of our capital obligations, including capital spending, both forward and catch up, the Lompico project, the unfunded liabilities in terms of pensions, reserves, basically all the categories that we tank maintenance, all the categories we can think of relative to what our capital obligations are going to be.
So capital obligations, yes, we will have the detailed capital plans for the next 2 years. As far as pension and OPEB, that is a discussion that we did start to have at the Budget and Finance Committee, is earmarking money to go towards funding those liabilities. Those are not factored into this budget.
No, I understand.
Yeah, the next meeting, once we have the rolled up package, we'll have some of the different proposals or ideas around, you know, depending on where we need to see kind of what the bottom line is shaking out to be. If there is extra money, you know, do we want to have it go towards paying down some of that pension liability? So that's going to be the next piece that the Budget and Finance Committee is taking on in April. And then we'll be bringing kind of that full roll-up package to that first board meeting in May.
Well, there's no extra money here, unfortunately. But I had shared with you and Rick before the capital obligation spreadsheet that I think has a list of all of the things that we could spend our capital on. Capital meaning operating revenues, revenues less expenses. That is our margin, what's left over. And that includes a lot of things, including, you know, roughly $10 million in tank maintenance that has not been, taken care of in the past. So I think it's really important this year that we get a full picture of what our true financial and capital obligations are going forward. Next question had to do with how are we accounting for the $3 million plus that we've spent so far on the fire recovery. It didn't seem like it was in these numbers, though I could be wrong about that.
It is not. The capital piece, you know, we haven't looked at the capital piece for the fires. So that's going to be coming as part of the capital. Part of that also what you'll see then is we'll be then projecting what the capital contributions are that we're receiving back from FEMA. So that's all going to be coming in the capital piece.
So I guess then the question is on the operating expense side, is the difference of roughly $400,000 then due to increased operating expenses associated with the CZU fire recovery?
And when you're saying 400, are you looking at overall operating expenses?
Yeah, I'm looking at the on page 23. I'm looking at the total operating expenses line. I'm seeing the estimated actuals is $8.5 million and the budget was $8.1
million. So you'll be seeing more of the CZU-related stuff in the specific categories of operating expense, maintenance, and facilities. You know, salaries is going up, obviously, because there's the headcount in there. From the discussion we just had, that's going to be going up even more.
Stephanie, I'm not talking about going forward. I'm talking about this year. There's a variance here in the operating expenses of $400,000. So are we, is that $400,000 associated totally with the CZU fire recovery?
A vast majority of it definitely is. I mean, because you know, you figure legal bills are, you know, that's impacting it. There is a lot more going on with legal right now. You know, part of it's going to be CZU, part of it some of the other stuff. So legal was about $100,000. And then the majority of the other stuff was tracking pretty close to budget. So it's, you know, the, that other 300 is going to be the CZU or COVID related. You know, we did have to buy, you know, a chunk of, you know, right, laptops and different stuff like that.
And on the items that are related to the CZU fire, are any of those recoverable?
Yes, they are. So a lot of our, a lot of the expense on my department of the sampling and pumping costs due to losing the surface water sources, a lot of that's going to be recoverable.
Okay, so there will be an offset of some amount of that $400,000 variance that will come back to us eventually.
Yes.
Okay. Let's see, next one, as I was going through the operating revenues, it seemed to me that we might want to account for the fire recovery surcharge a little bit differently. I guess I don't view those necessarily as operating revenues, since you know, they're really going, that that money, as I understand it, is really intended to cover our part of the capital obligations associated with CZU fire recovery. When all of that is recovered back from FEMA, assuming that we only have to spend $5 million, then our reserve accounts will be back to $3 million, what they were before the fire was completed. So the adding the $1 million in there makes it a little bit, I think it skews the numbers a little bit.
It gets a little tricky. And one of the reasons why I at least initially put it there is, one, so that we could see it now. But second, sure, we did finance, you know, part of that $15 million was us financing.
I understand.
So part of it's going to go towards paying down that debt in the future as well. So I'm totally open to ways of, you know, if we want to just consider it all more of a capital contribution, I can talk to the auditors and see if we can categorize it as a capital contribution.
Right. So what I did is I basically backed that out in terms of the numbers I went through. You know, unfortunately, I think we have another year here where our rate increase is basically almost completely consumed by operating expense increases. It's only in the year following that we see about a $300,000 reduction in operating expenses. That's also happens to be the year we don't have a rate increase. Having another year beyond that, I think, would have been instructive to be able to see where that operating expense number would ultimately go. And this is one of the reasons for having a multi-year budget. I'm glad we're starting with two. It's definitely an improvement over one, but ultimately I think we're going to need to get to at least 3 to 5 years with respect to at least high-level numbers, if not detailed numbers. So, you know, what's happening then is our operating margin, when we back out that $5 million, is really starting to go down, meaning that we have less margin available to apply to our capital obligations because our operating expenses continue to chew up 100% or virtually 100% of our rate increase. So that means then that we will start eating into our reserves if we keep increasing operating costs at the level that they have been increasing historically, which, as I've mentioned before, has been skyrocketing. So this is sort of not a great model for a capital intensive organization. Really, it just keeps us on the hamster wheel. And we aren't really making significant progress towards paying down and addressing those capital obligations in a fashion that we absolutely need to be doing. So I like what we're doing from a format point of view. I like what we're doing from a multi-year point of view. but we're still not addressing the fundamental financial issue that this district is facing, and which continues to be an unsustainable process here. If every year we're going to be chewing up 100% of our rate increases with operating expense increases, we'll never get ahead on the capital obligation. Let's see if I have any others.
Thank you.
I think that was it. Thank you.
Director Henry, did you have a comment or question?
Well, since I'm on the Budget Finance Committee meeting, I've been over this. Not really. I appreciate all the work that Stephanie has put into this. She tries to listen to the board and what their desires are. Some things right now are pretty difficult. And it seems that the whole world has problems with infrastructure and with what they owe to CalPERS or CalSTARS the list is endless. And we try to move along as best we can. Budgets are our best guesstimate based on history and our current financial situation, what's going to happen in the next couple of years. Things could change. They could get better, they could get worse. So I think that we're trying to look at things in a 2-year span, and things can change, bottom line. And we're making every effort to keep SLVWD moving along smoothly. That's all.
All right, thank you. Unless you have any comments you want to make to finish up, Stephanie?
I think that should pretty much cover it. I'll work with Rick on kind of the new definition of the position that we're talking about so that we can make sure we're factoring any increases for that as well in the next budget, the next budget round.
All right. And I just want to add to what Director Henry was saying is I was really glad at our last meeting that you had already started planning on making, you know, how we could go about having a strategy for making regular contributions to our pension and OPEB requirements. And I think that's a big step forward. So thank you for doing that. I look forward to seeing what you come up with. Okay, all right. With that, let's go on to our next.
Has there been public comment on this item?
Oh, I'm sorry. Are there any public comments out there? Seeing none, hearing none, we will go on to the next agenda item, which is to take a look at the revised letter to PG&E. Rick, did you want to, or Carly?
We will present this to this revised letter to the board.
Okay.
Great. Thank you, guys. So last board meeting, we brought a letter to PG&E addressing road mitigation, felled trees on district property, as well as their infrastructure. This originated in 2020 of last year. In May, we sent a letter to PG&E asking for more information about their clearing on district property from Empire Grade to Boulder Creek. We did receive a response on June 9th. Of 2020, and this is our follow-up as requested at the Environmental Committee back in January. So on March 18th, the Board of Directors reviewed the final draft and decided revisions were needed to ensure clear direction to PG&E, including response time, clear objectives, and edits to the CC contact list. Staff revised as directed and created the final letter attached. It is recommended that the Board of Directors review the letter, approve the letter for distribution to the recommended recipients, and approve the board president to sign the letter on behalf of the district.
Okay, All right. Since you weren't here at the last meeting when we discussed this, Director Foltz, you want to make any comments?
Well, I didn't have a lot. I think it looked like there was only one paragraph. It looked like there was only one paragraph added.
Yes.
At the end.
That's correct.
Yeah. I thought the letter was fine before. I think it's fine now. And you know, they responded quickly before. I don't expect that they won't respond quickly this time. So. Okay.
All right. Anybody else have a comment about this? Director Henry or Director Smalley? Yes. Director Smalley.
I reviewed the revised letter. Staff has addressed the comments that I made into it, pointing out with that concluding paragraph what we were asking PG&E to do, and they include a time frame when we were asking them to get back to us. So, yes, I believe that the letter is a better product right now, and without any other objections, I'd like to make the motion that the board approve the distribution of the letter to the recommended recipients and approve the board president to sign on behalf of the district.
Okay.
Moved and seconded. Holly, would you like to go ahead and
make we need to go to the public, please? Okay.
Yeah, the public.
Public, please.
All right. Elena Lang.
Hi there. Elena Lang, Boulder Creek. I just quick grammatical things. As far as using the Oxford comma in there, just stay consistent. One of the parts there was an Oxford comma. And then on the first page and on the second page, there wasn't. There's kind of some incorrectly placed commas, mainly just kind of like a overuse. And then just a suggested edit on the fuel versus fuels. I would take the S off. And there's the area where you start with an and then a comma, and then maybe something just like additionally. But that's it. Everything looked good. But I know it was really important to Bob that this looked professional. So as far as the grammatical side of it, that's all I had to say. Thank you.
Nancy Macy.
This letter is really important, and I'm very grateful that you are following through with it so beautifully. I appreciate the hard work that was done by the Environmental Committee. Bob, I understand you did a bunch of editing and added some good language. I'm grateful for that. I wanted to point out to you that the Santa Cruz Board of Supervisors sent a letter of complaint, a formal complaint to the CPUC. This is quite a process to do, and they are being responded to, and they are following up with it. And part of the complaint was that so many logs and things were left around, and it's a fire hazard. The people did not expect this to be happening, and I'm grateful that you're bringing that up. And the other piece to it is that we're not alone. The counties of Sonoma and Napa and Mendocino and the city of Santa Rosa have all sent in letters of concern and complaint to the CPUC, saying that they have been left with mountains of trees that are both a fire hazard, and the people who are trying to rebuild are having trouble rebuilding. They're considered a real problem. So I'm hoping that by adding your voice as a public agency, a water agency, that will make a wonderful big difference, and we can hope that there will be some changes made. Because I wasn't at all optimistic there was going to be any changes short of you know, civil action or criminal action against PG&E. So we might get by without that. Although the criminal part is still up in the air, I understand it, the information is from the CAL FIRE notices of violation, and the other two are being considered by the higher levels of the state of California. So this should be interesting to see what happens there. But thank you very much for following through. Our watershed is so valuable and so important, and you have you take such good care of it that now that we've had a bad fire, it's real important that that continue. And so I wish you luck with it, and I'm very excited about it and grateful that you're doing it. And anyway, good job, you guys. And it took everybody. It was a real teamwork, so thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. Anybody else have a comment? Okay, hearing none, seeing none. Can we now try the roll call vote?
President Mayhew?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Yes.
Director Foles?
Yes.
And Director Smalley?
Yes.
Motion passes.
We now move to the consent agenda, which has the one item on it, the Board of Directors meeting minutes for the 4th of March.
Pardon me? Are we going to talk about 13?
We haven't gotten there yet, Lois.
The consent agenda. Sorry. Got carried away with myself.
Director Foles.
Yes, I have a small number of recommendations for this that I'd like to propose.
Okay, go ahead.
On page 40, you know, this is not the easiest thing to do, especially with this format, but on page 41, fourth comment from the bottom of the page, I'd like to change the word questioned to requested. On the second, from the bottom of the page.
Did you catch that, or are you going to go back to the tape to find these?
Well, I think this is summary minutes, and so...
Yeah, no, I just want to make sure she's getting your comments.
Well, I can share them with her later. This is what makes this thing a little bit clumsy.
Yeah, I know, I understand. We have to do it here, so that's great. You'll share them with her later, but let's go through them now so we can all vote on them.
Yep. So, second from the bottom, I'd like to replace the word questioned with asked about, and replace the word possibility with options. So that line would read, he asked about our prepayment options. On page 42, in the middle of the page, it says, default said that due to the CZU fire, I would like to change that to read, defaults read a statement, period. He said that due to the CZU fire, is facing replacement costs. I'd like to insert the word uncertain in front of replacement.
Okay, are there any others?
Okay, one more. On page 45, the third paragraph from the top, it currently reads, default said that nothing he heard tonight changed his mind. I'd like to have that read, default read a statement, period. He said that nothing he heard tonight changed his mind. And that is it.
Okay. Does anybody else have a change to the minutes?
Could I ask what that was all about? When do we ever go through the minutes item by item and say,
Lois,
we want to change it?
But Director Henry, we talked about this last time, and we said that if Bob had things that he wanted changed and he didn't make them substantially larger, that we would do it in real time during the meeting. So he's doing exactly what I think we asked him to do the meeting before last.
So I'm doing exactly what the board agreed on.
Yeah. So yes. I don't agreed. I don't have any problem with what he just did. Any other changes? All right, then what do we need to vote to adopt the minutes as revised?
That's right, and there should be an opportunity for public comments.
Oh, I'm sorry. Gosh, I just never think they would care about the minutes, but go ahead. Are there any members of the public that would like to comment about the minutes or make changes to the minutes? Hearing none, seeing none, we'll go ahead and ask Holly to take a vote on.
Do we have a motion? I'd like to move that the board adopt the minutes as revised for March 4th, 2021.
Second?
Yes, so? I'll second that.
President Mayhood?
Aye.
Vice President Henry?
Abstain.
Director Fulce?
Yes.
Director Smalley?
Yes.
And next we go to item 13, which is the district report. We have the one that got to put in last time on the operations group, and James is here if anybody had any questions. Lois, did you have something on this one that you wanted to ask?
On district's reports?
Yes.
Well, I have some thoughts on this. Some that are, I like it, and some worries me. One of the things that bothers me when a board member asks, say James or our engineer or Stephanie a question, and they don't have an answer right off the top of their head, and they will say to whoever is asking the question, I don't have an answer right now, I'll get back to you. But the rest of us never see those answers. So to me, if the questions were put in writing and then the members of staff who would answer the questions would respond to all of us, then we would all know the answers. But we don't ever hear them. And I, for all I know, maybe the question never even got answered. The other problem I have with some of these, the questions being asked rather than being sent in writing to staff is that it prolongs the meeting. And we have staff who are at the meeting who've been at work since 6 a.m. or 7 a.m. And we're having this very long meeting. We also have members of the public that we have no idea how long they've been up. And I think that we need to care about staff and we need to care about the public. But then I do have a concern. Part of my concern is if we start sending everything in writing and 2022 is an election year and the FPPC, or the Fair Political Practice Commission, has real concerns about board members' names, and pictures of photos of board members. So if we start sending things in to staff, and if they respond to everybody and not respond necessarily just to the person who asked the question, I don't think there'd be an issue. But if they respond naming the person who asked the question, I don't know if there could possibly be an issue. And so that's kind of a concern I have, that come 2022, this could be an issue. So I really don't know how to go with this one. I could.
Gail, are we on an agenda item? I'm not following the agenda item.
Well, we're on district reports, and she's making
item 13.
Let me just answer one of the things here at Lois. Is it says under district reports that there's a preference that items be sent in writing to the staff person, and that person, the staff person, will provide answers, and they will appear along with the question in the next agenda packet. Now, that should take care of making sure that everybody gets them, and it should certainly make sure that we don't have any Brown Act issues or anything, you know, getting crosswise with elections related things. So I don't, you know, see that as a problem. I do agree with you that we don't want gratuitous questions or things that are kind of gotcha questions at the staff. And so and we don't want to make the meetings longer than they need to be. So that's in part why this says in writing that are encouraged that the questions be submitted in writing to the staff member. And I would encourage board members to do that for the reasons that Lois said, to respect our staff and respect our the public that's watching. Director Fultz?
Yeah, so there are a number of issues related here that were raised by Lois that I think are probably worthy of additional discussion, but perhaps on a more explicitly agendized topic. Since what I thought we were doing is talking about the operation status report, not status reports in general, or board behavior or what have you. I think we got kind of far afield here, and actually probably ended up extending the meeting even longer. Is this something that we can bring back to the board as a agendized topic, or do we want to send it to committee, or what? Are we saying specifically that no questions shall be asked during board meetings of the senior staff that are present?
That's not what the rules say here. The rules say it's preferred that you send them in emails, and I think that in most cases that we should respect that. There might be some issues that are, you know, more pressing or whatever, but I don't see this as a huge big deal, and I don't want to spend any more time on it tonight.
But Lois has made it a big deal. I think she raises some legitimate questions. So I do have a question for James about his report. It should be a very short one. And I believe actually that questions about the district reports actually can be very valuable to the community, not being a burden. But that's my philosophy, and Lois may have a different one. James, I did want to ask you, what is involved in abandoning the pipeline on California Drive?
So we have we have a single connection point, but that main line that we put in is abandoning a portion of that 2-inch line. So that 2-inch line continues down Riverside Avenue to the cul-de-sac at the end. It still serves some people off of that. So we got to disconnect there, reattach it to the pipe further down, making it a shorter section of 2-inch, feeding a few less homes. And then there's a couple meters that also have to be moved over that were on the Riverside side that weren't accounted for with the new main line, with that main line going dead. So we have to tie them over to the old main line on Riverside Avenue, which is the HUD line, which is a newer line.
Gotcha. For the way it was worded, I thought maybe you were doing something to the 2-inch pipe, not just leaving it in place, but you're just leaving the 2-inch pipe in place.
Yeah, so the 2-inch pipe portion of it is going to be abandoned in place, dead, and then filled with mortar so it doesn't pipe water anymore. And a portion of it is being reconnected to continue to serve the customers that are off.
Okay, the key was the mortar. Great. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions from the public?
I think Mark has a question.
Did you have a question on the operations report?
Yes, I do.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Okay. James, we briefly touched on meter replacements before. In future operations reports, could you include status of meter replacements on a, I don't know if it's on a percentage basis of here's what we completed versus here's what's still outstanding, something like that, to give us an assessment of that?
So my only question would be, do you want to see an annual installation changeover report, or do you want to see something like a age percentage report?
Maybe quarterly then, since I don't know that monthly is a good assessing this, but annual seems like a bit long period of time.
Yeah, no, I mean, I mean just a number of what's been changed like that fiscal year thus far, and or an age two percentage report. So I mean, there's two different ways of really presenting that.
Okay, I'd like to know how we're doing versus whatever the goal or what we were trying to achieve this year.
Okay, yes. I got you. That works.
Okay.
Stephanie's monthly report may include that information already on changeover.
Oh, okay.
And maybe that would be
the quarterly financial report does highlight the fixed assets. So, I mean, they kind of can go hand in hand. It can go
pretty
much with either one of us. You know, I kind of find out on the back end, he kind of knows on the front end and what he has coming up. So we could probably work together to get something.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We can.
Okay. That's fine.
Any other
I'll look there. In an effort to possibly shorten the agendas that we get, from pages 55 to 65, the hydrographs, the data, all of the numbers. I've seen these several times and I just page right by them. So
this is all holdover from past requests of past board members.
Oh, okay. All right. So
if you all want to make a recommendation that you don't need to see this information, but once a year, that's fine with me. You just make the recommendation.
Okay. I would be okay with that, but okay.
Director Fultz, did you have your hand up?
In general, I agree with Mark about what I would consider to be the level of detail that's in there. However, I think seeing the summary information about the water that we are producing and a summary of what's happening at Fall Creek is very helpful.
I think we're just talking about the bell graphs, right?
Yeah, so I would, James, if you wanted to, make it, I think, was certainly more meaningful to me. I don't know if it worked for everybody else, but moving to more of a graphical presentation like you have for your well drawdown reports, which I do look at and I do think are very important to see, would be helpful. But that's just a suggestion, not a recommendation.
And like I said, I could just put those in once a year. You know, I could put it in a schedule to where I put the well graphs in once a year. You guys get a high level look at them. And if you don't want to see them monthly, that's all of on your guys' recommendation.
I'm not sure I'm comfortable. I'm comfortable with annual, but I certainly think you could simplify the information while still communicating the important item.
Okay.
I'd just like to make a comment that I found looking at the graph for Fall Creek was really interesting, because if they adopted the what City of Santa Cruz wants to apply as bypass flows, Big Trees, 40 CFS, we would not have been able to take water out of Fall Creek 22 days out of February.
You're absolutely right, Gail.
I'll be sure to keep Fall Creek.
We need to fix that.
Yeah.
Now can I go to the public and see if there's any questions on the operations report? Beth Thomas.
Thank you, President Mahood. I just wanted to say, as a member of the community, that while I also, you know, I've attended millions of meetings in my work life over the years, but I do think that in a public institution, these meetings are really helpful for the community to learn about the water district and to learn in as much detail as they're willing to. They can always tune out when they need to. So I think it's an important educational community benefit. Thank you.
Cynthia Denzel.
I appreciate seeing the graphs and some of the data. And my concern is if we really need Fall Creek to support the rest of the district during emergencies, then we really need to rewrite the limits on when we can take that water out. And I don't think Fall Creek should be the only contribution to that flow that's considered. Maybe what we need to do is consider how much flow is needed in Fall Creek to maintain the fish, but we shouldn't be responsible for the total San Lorenzo River flow. Seems like City of Santa Cruz should have to release water from Loch Lomond. You know, there should be other factors besides just Fall Creek in getting that CFS. And I just want to say I really appreciate everything you guys do as far as all the time that you put in to educate the public. So thank you.
Thank you, Cynthia. Okay, anything else? Go ahead, Mark.
President Mahood, if I may, I'd like to give a brief summary of what we discussed at the last Santa Margarita Groundwater Association meeting. I know it's not on the agenda, but I think it's important for other directors.
Informational to hear. And brief.
Okay.
That's fine, but because it's not on the agenda, we cannot have a discussion because of the Brown Act. So as long as
it's
brief and friendly.
I understand. I'll keep it brief. At our last meeting, the consultant that the agency is using, Montgomery Associates, proposed setting target levels for where we would like the aquifers to recover to at a what I consider a stretch goal. In an ideal world, this is what we would like it to be. However, they wanted the directors to approve that. However, they were not able to provide us what the costs would be to approve that at the same time. Because of that, the board rejected their proposal and said they needed to come back with costs so that we could begin to assess that. So simply that. Thank you.
Bob, do you have your hand up?
Yes, I just have a request. Maybe for the next few months, we should have a Santa Margarita report on the agenda as a recurring topic.
Yes, in fact, Mark and I have discussed actually having sort of a presentation in the next month or two that would deal with greater detail as a regular agenda item. But your suggestion of just having a quick update like this is probably a good one.
Both would be good.
Okay. Let's see, anything else from the public? And if not, I think, are we done?
Just a quick, you do have a something in the back from the Boulder Creek Rec on their radio station. They're up and running and they are fantastically ecstatically and just having the greatest time of their life. And they thank the district and Rob Menzies, who was a district employee that started working with them, who's passed away. It's a great success story and a great partnership.
Story. All right. Thank you very much. Okay. Then we'll go ahead and adjourn. So thank you all.
Good night.
Okay. Thank you.